presentation was for the whole district, for parents of the Title I students, and the subject was early reading and learning about phonemic awareness, awareness of sounds, and the importance of listening and speaking, and lots of games and fun activities that went with that.
This is the building foundational skills for students as they begin reading, some of those areas, the readiness that they need in order to begin their reading process.
Okay, and why is it important for parents to hear this presentation?
I think this topic is really a hard one to understand, although it seems like it'd be very easy because it's different ways of looking at words and sounds and thinking about things you can do on the run just at a listening level.
Absolutely, and it's always important to have parent involvement because we couldn't do it without parents. We really need them involved. So it's always nice to have all of us on the same page, and here we can help the parents also understand what we do in school with their students every day.
So it is indeed a pleasure to be here tonight. I am delighted to be able to come and talk with you about probably one of my most favorite subjects, which is reading. And I get to work with reading at the intermediate unit on a daily basis, but I don't always get to come out and do what I call the fun stuff. And so tonight, I hope that while it got quiet in here with your children leaving, I am hoping to energize you and give you a little bit of information that we can talk about, we can share, and we can practice. I am here to share a bit about early reading and the kinds of things that you can do at home to support your child's development in learning how to read. But understand that your child's teachers are teaching your children all the skills that they need to know in order to become a reader. They are doing their job of teaching them how to become a reader. But what they would like you to do is to review and practice those skills. And I take a quote from one of my famous authors there, Dr. Seuss, where the more that you read, the more things you know, the more you learn, the more places you go. Okay, and we do know the more that our children read, the more that they will learn and they will grow in the world in which they live, right? Okay, so how do we develop a love of reading early in our children? We do that by reading their favorite stories over and over and over again. And we know children have those favorite stories because they ask for them to be read every night, don't they? I have two older children. I've got a 23-year-old and a 19-year-old, and the story I certainly remember reading over and over again was Goodnight Moon. That was one that I thought they have to know it by now, but they still wanted it to be read over and over again. So we know that when we do that with our children, it means something to them. We sing the alphabet song over and over again because that exposes them to the letters in our alphabet, and we're going to talk about tonight why that's important to do. We also see there that we're going to play with letters and sounds because all the letters in our alphabet have sounds that go with them, and those sounds are put together to form words that we use and see in print. So we absolutely want to play with those letters and sounds with our children, with rhymes, and expose them to rhymes and what rhymes are all about. It's also a very special time to bond with an adult in their life, whether that's a parent, an older sibling, a grandparent, a caregiver, a babysitter, anybody can become that favorite adult in terms of sharing that story time with them. It does help them grow, and it helps them experience things in the world and to get curious about things. They begin to ask questions about things that they notice in their world. So that's, again, how we really do establish that love of reading early in our children and letter knowledge. But I'd like to, for a moment, talk about the other skills that you see up there. The first one you see is language and narrative skills. And that really reflects talking with your child, talking and talking some more, bathing your children in conversation and in all the words that we have in our language. Computer screens and television screens don't replace adult interaction. So we want to encourage you to have those purposeful and meaningful conversations with your children every day. If we look over at print motivation and print awareness, we ask that you point out the print that's all around us. And print is everywhere, isn't it? It's in books, it's also in newspapers, it's in magazines, it's in flyers, it's on signs as you're driving down the road, it's on billboards, it's on the menus when you go out to eat. Print is everywhere. And so we want to bring that print awareness to our children. Make them notice the print that is all around us. If we look down at working with words and vocabulary, the only way to grow vocabulary is to talk to our children and talk some more. And I'd like to distinguish for us between routine talking and true meaningful conversation. By routine conversation, I'm thinking of things like brush your teeth, do your homework, clean your room, go to bed. All of that involves talking with our children, right? We're talking, but that's routine conversation. And we need to encourage there to be more meaningful conversation so that we can grow our children's vocabulary. That it's not just the routine talk, because what happens to our children when we start to just use routine talk? What do? Yeah, they memorize it, and they start to tune us out or turn us off, right? And then we wonder why they don't respond and do what we're asking them to do. So we want to encourage those more meaningful conversations. When we think about comprehension, whether you are reading to your child or whether your child begins to read to you, there are questions during that period of time that we encourage you to ask, like, what was that about? What do you think that means? And can you tell me the story in your own words? That tells us really what the child is thinking about as they are reading or being read to. So those questions are really important that we ask during that reading. And then last, if we look over and see written expression and fine motor, writing is when we take the opportunity to put a thought or an idea on paper. And early, it's represented maybe in pictures or drawings. And then our children begin to use letters and words to represent their thoughts and ideas. And so somewhere in your house, whether it's in the kitchen, it's in the dining room, it's in the playroom, the child's bedroom where their desk is, somewhere I encourage you to create an area that gives them all the tools that they might need in which to put their thoughts or ideas down on paper. So paper would be great to have in that area. Putting crayons and pencils and pens and markers and scissors, kind of like a Crayola fest. If you could have a corner in your home or a Tupperware container that might have all of those tools in order for your child to then begin to practice with writing and putting their thoughts and ideas down on paper, that would be a wonderful way to support what's happening in the school. So what we're going to do tonight, however, is focus on phonological awareness or letter knowledge. And I'd like to take the time to introduce phonological awareness to you. That is being aware of all the sounds in our language, the sounds that our letters represent, okay? So everybody say cat.
Cat.
Say cat.
Cat.
Listen, the sounds in cat are k, a, t. Everybody, what are the sounds in cat? K, a, t. What's the first sound in cat? What's the last sound in cat? What's the middle sound in cat? We just did a phonological awareness activity. It's becoming aware of the small sounds that make up our words in our language. Okay? Moving on to knowing that letters have different shapes. When our children are born and they're growing in their world, we begin to label for them the objects in their world, right? So this becomes a what? A table. We have chairs. We begin to label everything, right? And they're concrete objects. No matter what I do with that table or chair, it remains a table or chair, right? So everybody, what is this?
A watch.
What is it now?
A watch.
What is it now?
A watch.
If I could turn it inside out, what would it still be?
A watch.
Watch, okay? So our children grow up knowing that things represent what we tell them they represent, and it stays the same no matter the spatial orientation. So no matter how I turn it, it's a watch and always a watch, right? And duh looks like this. Everybody, what sound is this?
Yeah.
Duh. And it's the letter D. Okay? Now, and I have a great person back there who's really shouting out the answers, and I appreciate that. Okay, so now the teacher says, now this is our new sound, everybody. This is the letter P, and it says, what sound? Okay, and then here's another sound I'm gonna introduce you to. This is the letter Q, and it says, well, sometimes it says K, sometimes it says Qu. It depends on where you are and what word you're using. So all of a sudden, everything that our children learned growing up about language, words, and labeling things is now what? Very challenging and confusing, okay? Because it's the same shape, but depending on the spatial orientation, it means something different, it says something different, and it, in a word, completely changes what the word would be, right? Okay, so that is what we're talking about in terms of recognizing that our letters have different shapes, they have different sounds, and that we recognize those letters everywhere. So why is phonemic awareness important? And why do we focus on that in kindergarten and in first grade and through second grade and until our kids learn phonemic awareness? And that is because it prepares our readers to read print by helping them understand that those letters represent certain sounds. And then we also know that when we take apart a word and see its individual sounds, we then can put it back together. And when our children get to a point where they know the letters and sounds that they make, they can take apart a word and they can put a word back together, even the words that they don't know, okay? If they come upon an unfamiliar word, they have a way to figure it out by being able to take it apart, see all those individual sounds, and then put it back together to form the new word. So, what we're going to do, before I do this, let me show you what you have in terms of your packet there. You got two paper-clipped packets, or two stapled, maybe two stapled, it came together. Okay? Yeah, they have them. They have them, okay? The first one I'll call your attention to is the phonemic awareness one. There's a little definition there at the top for kindergarten. And then it gives you kind of those questions. What should my kindergartner be able to do? And you will see there, if you scan that little section, there are a lot of references there to rhyming, okay? If the word is, I'm thinking of a word that rhymes with hat. Everybody shout out a word that rhymes with hat. Get ready. Hat. Bat. Okay, again. So we're working a lot with rhyming words at the kindergarten level. Or we're looking at syllables, or the fact that words come in parts. Okay? My name is Terrie. That's two syllables or two word parts. When we talk about syllables with our children, it's best if we ask them to hum, to determine how many syllables are in a word. So if you practice with your neighbor saying your name, but hum it and count the syllables. So turn to your neighbor, someone that's sitting close to you, hum your first name and then hold up your fingers as to how many syllables was in your name. Go ahead, do that now.
Your
name is Jennifer. Let's hum the name Jennifer, everybody. Get ready. How many syllables?
Three.
And her partner is Julie. Everybody, let's hum Julie. Get ready. How many syllables?
Two.
Those are the kinds of things we're asking kindergartners to be able to do, and older children if they struggle with word parts. You'll see in the next section, it says, how can I help my child develop phonemic awareness skills? There are lots of ideas down there. Guess my word, I demonstrated that. I'm thinking of a word that rhymes with. So you could fill that in with your child and have them guess those words. Or I spy. I spy something that begins with a t sound. Anybody want to take a guess? Table. Okay, so again, you can do an I spy in your kitchen, in your living room, in your dining room, getting your children to spy things that begin with the target sound that you give them. And then down at the bottom, how can I help my child pull apart words and put words back together? Everybody familiar with the song? Not that I'd like to break out in song at this point because they're videotaping, but head, shoulders, knees, and toes. We know head, shoulders, knees and toes, knees and toes. So if we think of a word, and I'll use our word that I've been working with, cat. Everybody say cat.
Cat.
If I were going to break apart cat by head, shoulders, and in this case just knees, because I don't want to go all the way down to my toes. So cat, I would say k-a-t. What word? Cat. Okay, so playing that kind of game with your child where you give them a word and you ask them to pull it apart by its sounds in tapping head, shoulders, knees, or toes. That's another activity that you can do. And then on the back page, the next page, you will see if you are first grader or second grader. Again, explaining phonemic awareness, and you will see in first grade, we're asking children to begin to identify the beginning, middle, and end of words. Like I did at the beginning with what's the first sound in cat, what's the last sound, what's the middle sound. So again, you can see how we're growing your child in being able to recognize the beginning, middle, and end of sounds, of words now. And where we're in the middle there, you will see we're asking them to substitute a sound. Everybody say sat. What word do you get when we change s to p, everybody? Hat, okay? So we're gonna ask your child to start manipulating or changing sounds, deleting sounds, adding new sounds. That helps them grow in their phonemic awareness skills, okay? So you have those, and there are questions and answers in the back of that packet relative to phonemic awareness skills. And then you also have kindergarten through second grade, a little packet on phonics, helping you to understand what we're looking for in kindergarten and first grade, what we're looking for in second and third grade, and how it becomes a little, it grows itself. So by third grade, we're talking about prefixes and suffixes and root words. So it's going to be important that our kindergartners and first graders learn those earlier skills so that they're ready for some of the skills that get a little more difficult in second and third grade. And I believe everybody got two cards. You got a large card and you got a small card, okay? And I'm gonna refer to the big card as our elephant words. Everybody, what's the big card going to represent? Our elephant words. And our small card is going to represent our jelly bean words. What's the small card going to represent? Jelly bean words. And so this is an activity that you can do with your child in recognizing big words and little words. So if, for example, if I said to you, one of my cards is going to represent bed, and one of my cards is going to represent caterpillar. Show me bed. I'm gonna help you with the first one?
Yep.
Show me caterpillar. Okay, see how simple. Two cards, just asking your child to listen to the length of words. So let's try a few more. Everybody, show me blackboard. Show me ant. I should give you the two words. I'm sorry. Good, okay. The two words are dog and dinosaur. Show me dog. Show me dinosaur. Okay, Phyllis. Show me kind. Okay, very easy activity to do with basic listening. Okay, the next thing we're going to look at is sentence segmentation. And I need six volunteers. I promise I will not ask you to do anything that's difficult or that you can't do. And I even have a prize if you volunteer. So I need six people. One, two, three, four, five, six. Thank you. Come on up front. As my volunteers are coming up front, I'm going to hold up my sentence, line up here facing everybody in a single line. I'll be right with you. Okay, everybody, let's read this sentence together. Get ready. Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall. Okay, so watch what I'm going to do. It's a whole sentence, right? Thank you. Thank you. Okay, if I could ask my volunteers to hold it up real high so everybody can see it. Okay, boys and girls, this is what I would say. We're going to read a sentence together. Everybody get ready. Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall. Yeah, not fall. Okay, everybody, we have a missing word from our sentence, don't we? Let's see if we can find our missing word. Okay, get ready to read. Humpty. What word's missing? Dumpty. Let's turn and check if we're right. Is that Dumpty? Okay, let's read our sentence again, everybody. Get ready. Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall. Okay, that is a sentence activity that helps our kids begin to see that words are made up of, or sentences are made up of lots of words, right? And you're going to need your pack of Fruit Loops to participate in this activity. And what I'm going to ask you to do is put a handful of Fruit Loops kind of in the center black or big empty space of your big paper, kind of in the middle there. And we are going to build some sentences. And when I give you the sentence, I'm going to ask you to move a Fruit Loop down underneath the black line to represent every word in the sentence. Okay? So our first sentence is, I like cake. Everybody repeat that. I like cake. Show me I like cake by moving a Fruit Loop down to underneath the black line. Okay? Okay, check your neighbor. Make sure they understand. I like cake. So how many Fruit Loops did you have under your line?
Three.
Okay, very good. And I'm going to ask that you not eat them yet, okay? Move them back to the middle, because there will be a second activity in a few minutes that we'll do with them as well. Okay, so let's try another sentence. Okay, everybody listen. Today is Thursday. Everybody repeat the sentence. Today is Thursday. Show me today is Thursday. Where might our children who might not understand that words make up sentences, how many might they have put down there? What word might have tripped them? Today, they might have put two Fruit Loops, right? And what other word might have tripped them? Thursday, right? So we want children to understand today is Thursday. It's represented by three words. Okay, move them to the middle. Let's try another one. Sam likes to play basketball. Everybody, what sentence? Sam likes to play basketball. Build that sentence. Mom's checking here. That's good. Okay. How many Fruit Loops do you have under the line?
Five.
Right? It's a real deck of cards, but they're nice and narrow. So we can work with rhymes with our children with a deck of cards. If you have a deck of cards at home, you can and create rhymes. So if I come to you and you'd rather pass and not pick a card, I will not be offended. I don't want to put anybody on the spot, but you have such a beautiful smile. May I ask you to pick a card, please? And you pick the...
Do I look at it?
You're allowed to look. It's not magic trick. Oh, please, I'm not going to be a magician in my next life. Okay. Thank you. The card is up. Okay, so it's queen. Okay? So can you give me a word that rhymes with queen? Mean. Everybody, let's check that. Queen, mean. Do they sound the same?
Yes.
Great job. Thank you. And I'm going to ask for two more people. Anybody? Okay, what number did you pick? Four. Can you give me a word that rhymes with four? Poor. Everybody, let's check that. Four. Poor. Do they sound the same?
Yes.
Yes. My little friend in the stroller thinks so too. And may I ask? Okay, what number? Two. Can you give me a word that rhymes with two?
Shoe.
Shoe. Everybody, let's check that. Two. Shoe. Do they rhyme?
Yes.
Okay. So again, a very quick, simple, easy way. There's no card in the deck of cards that you have to take out. Okay? And even if your child comes up with a make-believe word, but it rhymes, that's okay. Okay, we're not asking for them to all be real words. They can come up with a make-believe word. We are most interested in the rhyming aspect of that activity. We are going to create a story, and the story is about a friendly creature named Ed. Okay, so once there was a creature named Ed, he started out with a great big head. Would somebody be willing to come up and put a head of Ed on our chart? Thank you. I'll even let you pick whatever marker you want. And when you're finished with Ed's head, you may take a lollipop. Okay. So let's see Ed's head. Ah, wonderful. That's a good head.
Be
a nervous wreck if you give this creature a neck. Would somebody like to come up and draw the neck? Thank you. Let's see the neck that we get on Ed. You want a lollipop, see? I know better. You're all just like your kids. You will work for a treat. Okay. Look at Roddy. Let us give him a nice big body. Somebody draw the body for us. Oh, you've been volunteered. Come up to draw the body. Even though he'll do no harm, on each side, he needs an arm. Would somebody come up and put an arm on each side? I know, and they're even smelly markers, so I'm surprised somebody hasn't taken up. Yeah. Okay, while he's drawing his arms, since it's hard to walk on wooden pegs, let's give our creature two long
legs.
Anybody like to put legs on Ed? Thank you. Now our Ed is finally done. Wasn't that a lot of
fun?
Would somebody care to come up and make Ed at least look fun? How would we make him look fun? Yeah. Who would like to draw a smile on Ed? Can I ask? Yes. Thank you. Oh. You can help too and make him look fun. Both of you can find a way to make him look fun and get a lollipop. Okay, so we were drawing a rhyme, a line at a time. Really engaging and fun to do. You can look at how fun they are making. And I love it. They're using the colors I have there. An artist in every room. Okay. Again, rhyming, simple, but yet really engaging and fun for our kiddos. When we were talking about our names and humming the syllables is a really great way for us to focus our kids' attention on those word parts. We used to always clap the syllables, you know, Mary, little, but what we found is that's hard for kids to count and clap. So if you hum, they have a hand in which to count the syllables that they're humming. So that's why we really recommend humming out those syllables, okay? So, we're gonna play with some syllables all together, and I'm gonna say these parts of words, and we're gonna hum them and figure out. So the word is pepper. Everybody hum pepper. Show me with your fingers how many syllables in pepper. Very good, two, great. Next word, butterfly, hum it. How many sounds? How many word parts? Three, right? Three syllables. Everybody say meatloaf.
Meatloaf.
Say meatloaf.
Meatloaf.
Say it again without meat. What word?
Loaf.
Loaf. Say classmates.
Classmates.
Say classmates.
Classmates.
Say classmates without class.
Mates.
Say hiccup.
Hiccup.
Say hiccup.
Hiccup.
Say hiccup without hick. Okay, very good. Okay. Say snowman.
Snowman.
Which we don't want. Snowman.
Snowman.
Say snowman without man.
Snow.
Say winter.
Winter.
Say winter.
Winter.
Say winter without tur.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you see how I began to change that now even to the parts of the word. Next activity, we're gonna go down to the phoneme level. You all, I believe, were given a rubber band, okay? And somewhere on that rubber band, you will see the word man is written on the rubber band. I ask you to put man between your two thumbs, okay? The word is man. And when you stretch the rubber band, we're going to say that word and stretch it out as we're saying it. So example, I would say, man. Okay, everybody do that with me, get ready. Man, what word, put it back together? Man, okay? So you see on the rubber band, it didn't distort those letters to the point where a child couldn't read them, but it's a great gross motor or movement activity to help our kids understand when we are stretching words and when we're putting them back together, okay? The nice thing about the rubber band is that it's big enough that you can write a word on the back, okay? You can turn it inside out and write two more words, so you can get four words on one rubber band. And when you leave tonight, you are going to take a packet of activities that you could do at home. And within that packet, there are lots of words just like man. You don't have to think of them. I've given them to you on a sheet of paper. So you can write on your rubber band three more words. Sat, okay, is another one that you can use. So it's a great activity. You just may have to have a conversation about what we don't do with our rubber band words, right? Because this is a pretty thick rubber band clip that I'd like to end with that gives you some examples of activities that you could do at home with your child. And as Kathy's getting that set up, I'm also going to show you there. When you leave, you will be picking up a whole packet of activities that are ready to go for you to practice and do some things together with your child at home to practice and review all of these early reading skills. So you'll be able to pick them up when you leave, but let's see if we can get them out.
Tonight's presentation was about phonemic awareness and phonics, which are important foundational skills for beginning readers. Terrie Geisel from the intermediate unit did tonight's presentation and does an excellent job and brings it down to a level that parents can understand. It gives them an opportunity to see the kinds of activities that their kids are engaged in every day. So they get a chance to see what it looks like, use the same language, and that's really important for the kids so that we can provide them with consistency and support them with what they need to grow with.